Welcome to my podcast. I'm Jay Cutler, and this is Uncut with Jay Cutler. This is podcast number one. Not exactly sure what I'm doing, how this is going to go, what to expect, but we're doing it. And you're going to be along this ride with me. I'm going to be talking to friends, maybe some family, some people I played football with, some coaches, some people I don't even know. Want to learn some things, want to have some fun. So it's going to be an interesting experience, and I'm super excited about it. And, you know, for you, everyone listening, I hope you enjoy it also. It is going to be a learning curve. There's going to be some ups and downs like everything else, but it should be fun. And I just joined Twitter. That's kind of the newest phase in my life. And I, as well, doing this podcast. So you can find me, Jay Has Tweets. I have to look at it to make sure. Yes, Jay Has Tweets on Twitter. Hit me up if there's anything that you want to hear, any guests that you want me to try to get on, questions, comments, the whole thing. Like I said, when I joined Twitter, it's the wild, wild west of social media. And I feel like podcasts kind of lends itself to that also. You can find me on If Jay Had Instagram. Also, if you prefer that method. With that being said, I think we're just kind of going to launch into this and just kind of throw ourselves in the pool. This week, we're doing Tom Waddle and Mark Silverman from the Waddle and Sylvie Show in Chicago. And a little background on them. I did a radio show with them for a number of years in studio. We toured around Chicago to bars and restaurants and had a lot of fun. There were some tense moments with Sylvie that we'll get into, I'm sure. But at this point in my life and their life, they've become more friends than anything else. They've been very supportive from my first day in Chicago to my last day. So I'm pretty excited about this one. I think it's going to be a fun one. It's going to be probably loose and we should have fun. So let's do it. Let's get these guys on right away. Tom, Sylvie, let's do this. All right. Welcoming to the show, Waddle and Sylvie. Known these two for a long time, from Chicago, did a radio show with them, gave them a lot of hell. They gave me some crap back. But thanks guys. Thanks for coming on.
Can't believe thank this. You. Yeah, I said this just a minute ago, but my goodness, the tables have turned. Before, you were the unwilling participant sitting next to us as we were trying to get stuff out of you, and now it's your job to try to get us to say something.
Exactly. I don't know if unwilling was. I mean, you guys paid me, so
yeah,
I was semi-willing to do it.
The first 20 minutes, though, were always a little bit tense. And then the last 40 minutes were fun as hell.
Yeah.
But you were certainly willing. And
well, that's because the first 20 minutes of it, you wanted to be, you know, the hard hitting reporter and you know, just grill me, right? Right, Tom?
Morley Safer.
Yeah. I was there to provide some sort of buffer between the hard hitting interview and, hey, let's just have some fun and you know, talk about things outside of football. But Sylvie and I always say, Jay, like it was at times it was tense. 99% of the time, it's some of the best radio that we've ever done over the course of the 14 plus years that we've been together. And we do take a little bit of credit for bringing your effervescent personality to the masses in Chicago that hadn't seen it prior.
A lot of credit.
Yes. He said a little bit. You said a lot. So we'll split the difference. I appreciate that you guys saying that. And I will give you guys a lot of credit. We had a ton of fun. For everyone listening and viewing in, I did a radio show for how long did we do that?
Sylvie, you would know.
Three years?
Well, you used to call in a lot.
Yeah, we called in. And then two or three years.
3 years.
Yeah.
And the one thing, Jay, that I'll always say is, you know, I think you were the only quarterback in the National Football League that did a weekly show in front of a crowd. Yeah, you know, there are other guys who used to call in, like Eli would call into the Fan, I think. Brady has always called in weekly. Guys call in. But to have you, like, there the Monday or the Tuesday after a game, we would have 500 to 1,000 people. And it was just incredible at times.
Yeah, I mean, we toured around. We went to the bars. I mean, we were kind of all over Chicago for a little bit. It was a lot of fun. And, you know, I think you guys did a really good job of bringing out kind of my personality and having fun. And I do owe you guys a debt of gratitude for that one.
I would ask you, we'll get to the meat conversation, I'm sure, soon. Did you know at any point during the show that you did with us that this was something ultimately that you would be interested in doing when your football career was over?
Not at all. Not even close. I this was not on my radar. I enjoyed it. I it was easy. It was fun. But I mean, the podcasts really weren't a thing at that point. You know, the internet. I mean, the whole spectrum has kind of changed. So I didn't think that I'd get into this. But I also didn't have any idea what I was going to do. You know, there was never a point in my career where I was like, hey, as soon as I'm done, you know, I'm going to launch into X, Y, and Z. It was more just, hey, I'm going to play football until I don't want to play football, or they tell me I can't play football, and then, you know, we'll figure that out. So I think that's been kind of the journey the last couple of years, saying, hey, like, what exactly do I want to do next? And I want to make sure it's fun. I want to make sure it's not something that I dread doing a year from now and all those things. So that's been kind of where I've landed on this. And this is fun. I mean, being able to talk to, you know, guys that I'm comfortable with, cool with, and going forward, talking to people that I can learn some stuff from, and it's going to be an interesting journey. So I'm looking forward to it.
How long's the list?
The list
of comfortable people. Yeah. Like the comfortable people, how long, where does it start and where does it end?
I mean, it's like one, and then it stops like at three. I'm joking. We got a good list. I mean, I think we're scheduled out here for a little bit of time, but you know, there's also like in this world, as you guys know, there's something that happens every day, once a week. So, you know, there could be anybody that hopefully pops in and we're able to talk to, and that's the idea about it. I mean, so we'll see how it goes. I mean, I'm not sure. You know, this is I'm kind of flying by the seat of my pants right now.
Are we allowed to swear?
Yeah, say whatever you want. I think
I can. I was wondering.
I was just going to say, if we're your first guest, that's a shitty list.
It is. I mean, I mean, what if I tell you you're my 12th guest?
But then it's a great list.
It's a great list. Okay.
To kick off your career in this field, to have Sylvie and me doing this, I would just say, wow. I mean, I don't know. Get that list going, will you?
It's going. You guys will be fine. And I think I did it more for Sylvie than for you. Of all the years of me abusing him on air.
Look, I gotta say, like, I've been telling my friends, I'm like, you're not gonna believe this.
Yeah.
We're fucking going on Jay Cutler's podcast. I'm like, he's totally got something. Like, this is gonna be like a Maury show where someone comes out from behind the wall.
Sylvie,
I've got a surprise for you after all these years of torturing me and asking me questions. This now is for you. The tables are turned.
Exactly. I thought about doing that, but opted out. You guys are still doing your show and everything, right?
Yeah, I hope so.
Listen.
Did last year you guys just did it remote or?
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you guys back in studio or no?
Oh, yeah. We've been back in studio for a very long time. We did it remote. How long would you say, Silva, we did it remote? Maybe, was it 3 or 4 months?
Do it longer. You know, I went through, I was diagnosed with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma a year ago, April.
Yeah. Yeah.
So like last summer at this time, Labor Day is my 1 year anniversary of my last treatment for chemo. So I had to be inside more, you know, until everything kind of got in the clear. And now I'm living life again, maybe living life a little harder because I'm on the other side of this.
How are you living life harder now? Just enjoying life and just enjoying life more or?
Yes. Okay. I mean, you know, with the kids, like this weekend I was in an indoor water park. Great America yesterday. I'm just appreciating being out more. than I ever have. I mean, to go through last year, you know, with everything total, it just makes you sort of appreciate. Believe me, I'm still a red ass, and I still stress over everything, as you know. Waddle can attest. But it makes you appreciate when you can actually live and drink and have fun.
Yeah,
I mean, I would say this as well, Jay, because like the Sylvie that you were first introduced to the Sylvie that exists today, he's married, he's got two kids.
Yeah.
He's gone through some things in his own life. He used to grip the bat handle, as you know, so tight it would turn into sawdust in his hands. He's a different cat now, and I think that you've experienced that when you've come back to Chicago over the last several years. And
absolutely,
like, there's nobody who's more passionate about his job than Sylvie. But we always used to give him shit for, you know, hey, like, enjoy it too. I mean,
yeah, there's other aspects besides just this one bucket here.
And I can tell you that, you know, he's a joy to work with now. And
he was shitty as hell before, but he's awesome now.
It wasn't shitty, but there were trying times when we would look at each other and I'd be like, and this is really early, and I'm like, dude, does it really bother you that much that you're gonna yell at me about the fucking Cubs second baseman booting the ball all over the field? Yeah. Like, I didn't do it. B, there's another game tonight because there's 162 of these. And it's just been a different dynamic. And I think Sylvie would agree with it. And it's like our relationship has always been good, but it's never been better than it is now.
I mean, he's obviously your work wife, Tommy, but like how long have you guys been married together like this?
14 years.
And you guys are in the you know, the twilight of your marriage together. It sounds like things have never been better. I mean,
we're right. Look
at you guys.
You know what's funny, Jay? He has Waddle. I don't know if you know. He has this well-known Super Bowl party where everybody wants the invite. And if you're not here.
I never got an invite to that.
You got the invite,
so I can come this year.
Yeah, you should definitely come this year.
Okay.
And so a couple of years ago, John Fox was at the Super Bowl party.
Yeah.
And I'm tipping a few back, and Waddle's got the big office, and he's got a picture of Harbaugh, and he's got a picture of probably his BC quarterback who he went to high school with. Mm-hmm. There may have even been a picture of you and him, I think, in there. And I'm like, dude, what the fuck? I go, I'm your longest teammate. Fuck Harbaugh. Fuck all these other guys. Why isn't there a picture of me in here? I'm your longest teammate.
Yeah. Uh-oh.
I'm going to find one.
He probably has it's probably framed in a drawer or something. He just pulls it out from time to time, just looks at it.
Oh, yeah. It's a presentation picture for sure when I'm over at the house.
Exactly. Oh, Sylvie's coming over. Put the picture out.
I'm not going to lie. I'm stuck behind a picture of my mom and dad.
Uh-oh.
But here it is. It's Sylvie and I. We're at where are we at? We're at the Kentucky Derby.
I was about to say, that's a Derby picture, isn't it? You guys look good.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
Not bad. Same. Like, his shirt matches my pants. And we talked about we didn't talk about that. Like, that's it. That's the only picture I have of you, Sylvie. Sorry.
I know.
Cuddy, I have a picture. I have a picture of you in the office. You want to see this picture?
Maybe. Maybe. I don't know yet.
Yeah, you may. I don't know. Like, I think this is a rare one right here. I don't know if you remember this Nike town.
Oh, I do. I do remember that. I do remember that. That was
you, me, and Brian.
Yeah. Yep.
That was back in the days when you guys were all swollen up.
That was that was a long time ago. Hey guys, fantasy football is back, and there's a new app in town. It's called Sleeper. Let me tell you about it. Sleeper is a modern fantasy experience designed to connect people over sports with its integrated chat and sleek interface. Sleeper users talk more to their league mates, and their leagues simply feel that difference. It's free, and like most apps, with zero ads. It's a genuinely premium experience. Sleeper offers fantasy NFL, NBA, and even LCS League of Legends, and it gives you total control of your fantasy draft and season. Redraft, Dynasty, best ball, this app is made to play fantasy sports your way. Sleeper is the fastest growing fantasy platform. Co-founded by two childhood best friends who used to send trading cards via snail mail after their families moved to opposite coasts. They eventually discovered fantasy sports, and it became the glue of their friendship. Sleeper is the app they wish they had growing up, and they continue to use it to deepen friendships and keep people connected. Available at the App Store, Google Play, or on your desktop. Go to the App Store and download the Sleeper app and start playing today. All right, Sylvie, I know you want to do it. So before you have a stroke or something, let's talk Bears football and Justin Fields. Don't act like you don't care.
No, I'm super excited. But, you know, and I think that's how we got introduced to you. Like, yeah. If anyone was over the top, it was the two of us, Waddle sure. and me, when we got you. Like, we wished each other a happy Jay Cutler Day. I can tell you it's April 2nd, 2009.
Wow.
It got weird.
You know, yeah, it did get a little weird.
Yeah, it got weird. I got hammered on scotch that night. It was fantastic. And it's just the excitement of, you know, it's kind of like dating again, you know? And you should know this. And you meet someone new.
Okay.
And
walk me down this path. I'm excited for this. Keep going.
And look, you don't know if you're going to get married. You don't know if you're going to be dating a year.
No.
But you know after the first date that, shit, this feels different.
Absolutely.
I'm super excited.
Yes.
And that's how I feel now about Fields, that he's in the Bears, you know.
I mean, is there a little bit of hesitation there, or are you all in? Because like you said, it is like dating again, which is hard. It's hard as hell. Yeah,
really?
Yeah.
Is it? Not sorry. When you're Jay Cutler.
It is hard.
Oh, shit.
Meeting people
is so hard. What's so hard about it?
I mean, I think, you know, finding out what people really, really want from you. I think that's probably an issue. You know, and I'm at a different phase in my life now, you know, with kids and priorities are just changed. Like, it isn't just a purely selfish play by my part. Like, there's a lot of other aspects that have to be taken into consideration whenever you get back out into that world. And the whole landscape has changed. You know, there's apps, there's Twitter, there's Instagram. Like, it's a whole different ballgame. Like, you're not just walking into a restaurant or a bar and talking to somebody. Like, that doesn't exist anymore.
Are you on an app?
Wait a second. Can I ask two questions? Sylvie, what are you looking for in your next quarterback? Jay, what are you looking for in your next date?
Okay. I don't know. I honestly don't know that. I wish I knew. I think I'm trying to figure that out throughout this process. But I will. It's not a rush. It's not a rush for me at this point.
Okay.
And what I'm looking for is I am looking to rush. I am looking to get excited.
You're looking to fall in love.
Celebrate
ASAP.
Yes. It's pedal to the metal, Jay. Yes. There's no holding back at this point. What fun is it if you hold back? Who gives a shit if you get hurt again? Like, I'm saying, me as a Bears fan.
Okay.
I want to win a Super Bowl as a Bears fan. I want my kids to see a Super Bowl championship.
Yeah. And so are you back on, I mean, are you a fan of the head coach again, or just Justin Fields is going to do this himself?
I'm a fan of the guy. I love Nagy as a guy. Like, he is super cool. He's a good dude. You'd love him as a neighbor. I always joke about that. Pace and Nagy, if you bought a new house in Tennessee and you needed neighbors, and I know your neighbors are further away than my neighbors.
Yeah.
But if I moved to Tennessee and I wanted to move in with two neighbors, I'd want Ryan Pace on my left and Matt Nagy on my right. They're great neighbors to have. But do I want them as my coach and my general manager? And they have – look, I think Matt Nagy, the thing that I hesitate about, Jay, is I still don't know if he's a good offensive coordinator. They always rate at the bottom. He fired himself as the OC last year. In the short stint as OC under Andy Reid, remember that game against Tennessee, he abandoned the run. I like Matt as a leader. I don't love him running my offense, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it makes sense to me. Like, you want Matt and Ryan to come over for a cookout, but you don't want them calling your plays or picking your talent. And there was some bad news that we got today as well, that Tevin Jenkins, the guy they moved up for in the second round as their offensive left tackle of the future, is having back surgery today. So we go back into that conversation again about whether or not you were aware of some of the damaged goods, or – this is something that happened once he became a Bear, but it's just, it's been bad news. I agree with everything Sylvie said. You want to talk about a couple of great guys. Matt Nagy and Ryan Pace are wonderful guys. Their track record's a little sketchy right now, so I think the jury is more than a little bit out on both of them.
Yeah, I mean, I think you guys are 100% correct. And I think the problem with Nagy is he came in as the OC, his offense, it's his baby, and I think it's really hard for someone, like if you have a ton of success in that world, I think it's easy to mentor somebody and kind of oversee it. But like, if you're kind of stop and go up and down, like him as a person, I'm sure wants to go out there and prove like, hey, I can call plays. I can make this happen. So it's a difficult spot for me. Is he calling them now?
Yes. He's back to calling plays. And look, part of it is as well, like I have some sympathy for him because he came into a situation, his eyes were open and he decided to take this opportunity.
Yeah,
but Mitch Trubisky wasn't his quarterback. It wasn't his pick. And I think going forward for the 3 years that they were together, that I don't think Matt ever really did a great job getting the best out of the limited skill set that Mitch had. And I just didn't think it ever meshed. And I wouldn't tell you that he didn't coach Mitch with, you know, the intensity that he should have because he didn't pick him. But I think it's different when now Matt, Justin Fields is Matt's guy. Yeah. So I think that there's a different dynamic. Am I guaranteeing that it will be a better outcome? No, I think the jury is still out.
For
but
sure.
I think that the marriage between the coach and the quarterback that is oh so important when the coach is an offensive guy, it's good to have your guy in there. And, Jay, you could probably speak to that, the different places that you've been. If you aren't the guy that was selected by the head coach, there's always going to be a little bit of friction that may keep you both from reaching – where you should be.
Oh, on both sides, there's going to be that little bit of doubt in there saying, you know, you go into a game thinking, all right, you know, these guys aren't 100% behind me. You know, I've got to go out there and, you know, I can't just do my job. I got to do a little bit above that to win their approval. And I think on the other side as a coach, you know, Nagy's out there calling plays. He's like, you know, I don't really, in the back of his mind, he's like, I don't really believe in this guy. So, you know, it's 3rd and 7. He's like, hell, like, I can't call what I want to call. I've got to do something different. I've got to create plays for him. I got to create spaces for him. And that's hard. The way the NFL is right now, it's hard as an offensive coordinator to, you know, dial up, you know, that touchdown pass that Justin Fields hit. Like, you know, that's a great call. He's, you know, the tight end snuck it. But I mean, like, once every 3 games, 4 games, you might get one of those. Like, it's just really hard to create like wide ass open people like that. It just doesn't happen.
By the way, we talked about this yesterday. That's dirty fucking pool in the first preseason game, isn't it? Like,
gosh.
Honestly, like, you know, the Dolphins are not scheming for anything.
No, what, like, was it third quarter, fourth quarter? Which one was it?
Third quarter. And it was don't get me wrong, it's a beautifully designed play with a tight end sneak out. That's a play that you put in and that you game plan for in week 4 against the Lions because you know their tendencies.
Yep.
They broke that shit out in the third quarter. And I look,
they used to do that with Mitch Waddle.
Well, he was like, I mean, he's like first preseason game, like, we need to make a splash.
Yes,
like,
we need
a positive play. We need to make a splash. Yes, dial this bastard up and watch what happens. This is going to be a walk.
Like, you know, Brian Flores, the Dolphins coach, is standing on the sideline going, did he just do that? Like,
really, guys?
I'm a 3's in. We're not game planning for anything. Yeah. But with that said, I don't blame him for doing it because he's working with a young quarterback, and you need to give these guys something to feel great about themselves. So dirty pool, but appropriate dirty pool.
Absolutely. I mean, you got to build confidence. You've got to get the kid confidence. And I think Matt knows that, you know, if he goes out there and he has a bad performance, you know, whatever happens, incompletions, pick, whatever happens. I think he's smart enough to know the city of Chicago needed that to happen. They needed positivity and they needed some splash plays. They needed exactly what they got. So, but it doesn't really help Justin that much in the long run, because it's not always going to be that easy. It's going to get tough, and there's going to be some ups and some and a lot of downs. And I think that's going to be the growing process to get through.
Yeah, I said
Waddle. Does Mitch airmail that throw though?
This is Sylvia. It's easy for us to take those pot shots. Here's the two things, and I think it speaks to what Jay's talking about. The scramble for a touchdown that everyone was drooling about and couldn't keep their pants on over, Mitch did that against the Patriots.
Yeah.
The throw, the wide open touchdown pass to Jesse James, yeah, Mitch has done that. What Mitch wasn't able to do was to look like he felt comfortable in the position and use the defensive, you know, the defensive back's aggression against him and bait him to come in and then dump it off. Justin Fields looks like he came out of the womb playing quarterback. And I don't want to bang on Mitch here, but like Mitch, to me, the Mitch situation was Mitch was the best quarterback in the community grew up in Ohio when he was 6 years old. So they said best athlete. So they put him at quarterback. Mm-hmm. And then he became the best athlete of high school. So he was quarterback there. And then the progression went on. I never, when I put film on of Mitch, felt like Mitch felt comfortable as a quarterback.
Yeah, it's a different vibe.
Yeah, and when you watch Justin in even a short sample size, you get an entirely different feel. So to me, I was most impressed with the less obvious than I was the obvious touchdowns that were scored.
Yeah, the first series was a little rough. You know, they had a couple penalties. They were probably going to get a delay game if Buddy didn't jump off sides. But after that, I mean, he settled down, thought he moved well. You know, he hit the shots he should hit. And, I mean, he looked like he was in control of the offense. You know, that being said, it's preseason one. So we'll see what
happens. Don't rain on parades. So he's been away
from Jay tweeted, I remember my first preseason game.
But I then followed it up with, hey, he looks good. I hope he's great, or, you know, whatever I did say. But Twitter, also, I'm on Twitter now, which is it's a full-time job keeping up with Twitter. Like, I really want to hire someone. I'm not going to, but I want to hire someone just like to, you know, wade through all this for me. Like, there's so much happening 24/7. Do people not sleep?
People don't sleep. No, like guys like Big Cat, who does such a good job.
Yeah,
like we've joked, Jay, how many people do you think are on Tom Brady's team? Like, he's constantly doing it, and we know he's he's not that funny.
I mean, Tom might be funny, but like you said, he's not. Someone's writing his jokes.
I'm guessing.
I don't know. Like his jokes at the White House, someone wrote those. Those aren't his jokes.
Oh yeah, for sure. Just like any comedian's got a writer, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So
I mean,
a football player needs a writer.
Yeah.
I mean, come on.
I need a writer. Someone get me. I need a writer.
You don't. You're witty. That's what. That's
it's just hard to keep up with it every day. You know, like, I think Twitter is one of those things where it's quantity, not quality.
Right.
And Instagram's a little bit different. So it's hard to be funny, witty, and on top of it 8 times a day. Like, I don't have the time in my life to do that.
I'm surprised that you want to keep up with it, though, now.
Well, I'm in it now, and we're doing this podcast. So I think it's just kind of, it's like hand in hand. Like, I'm living a life that I didn't think I was going to live. I don't even know myself right now.
I think what Sylvie and I have learned over the course of time, and we have to tell each other every day about it, is listen, Twitter can be very good for gathering and sending out information, but you can't give oxygen to the nonsense, because you are going to find it. There's more nonsense than there is positivity, and you just have to turn and walk away from it sometimes, because it's everybody's opportunity to kind of have their voice heard and give you what their thoughts are without any ramifications at all. So it is a bit of a weird, it's a weird dynamic, but in the occupation we're in, and I think Sylvie would agree wholeheartedly, it's required.
Let
me ask you a question. We sit around, us dorks, especially me, not Waddle, and we think about, what's a clever fantasy football team name this year? What would be new? What would be hip? What would be funny?
Yeah.
Did you sit around and put thought into what your new Twitter handle was going to be?
So I'm in an office now with a group of people that I enjoy working with. And we did, we sat around and we had a whiteboard and we were writing down different stuff, seeing what was available. We're trying to change my Instagram, but Instagram hates me. So like they won't respond. But yes, we had a brainstorming session for about half a day about it.
I love it.
Does that mean Mark Block standing in front of the whiteboard with a marker and he's writing things up and you say yes or no? Or do you give Mark the full authority to decide on things?
No, he gets no authority to decide on anything.
Okay.
He just writes. Like, hey, write what we tell you to write. Hey, can we talk about, I just saw this new taunting penalty. Is this a thing?
Yes, yeah. Waddle. I brought this up to Waddle. I don't like it.
So what is the penalty? Can someone explain it to me? Like, what can't you do?
I believe you can't do something directed at someone. So even if it's a benign thing, whether it's spinning a ball,
yeah,
and they spin the ball like in front of somebody, you've taunted them, which is stupid. Like, let guys just be guys. That's my opinion. Why let these officials? Officiating in the NFL is the shittiest it's ever been.
It's impossible.
Yeah. Right. Why give them more things to have them keep their eye on and that they need to throw flags for? That's not what the consumers want. It's not what we want for entertainment.
No. Well, it sounds like, the NFL can't decide what they want to do. Because, a couple years ago, they changed the celebration. Now they're going back like on this taunting thing, which is a form of celebration. I saw one, I think it was like the Cowboys, and he broke a couple tackles, had a little mosh pit, kept going. And then I don't even know if he did anything and they threw a flag. And I was like, what is happening right now?
We've lost common sense as our guide. Like, what was the old statement?
Well, I think the whole world has lost common sense in a lot of aspects.
That's fair. But the old statement was, what is porn? You'll know it when you see it.
Yeah.
Like, I would use the same principle. What is an inappropriate celebration? You'll know it when you see it. It's
absolutely.
When you take the football, throw it at the head of the defender who was covering you. That's a taunting penalty. 99% of the other stuff isn't. If you're not outwardly showing disrespect to the person that you're playing against, then celebrate your ass off.
Absolutely.
Don't care. I think
that's what the people want to see. It's fun. It's fun. It's a fun game. Like, let's enjoy it.
Yeah.
What was the best taunt that you were ever on the delivery end of or the receiving end of back in your playing days?
I was literally about that. That was a fun one. I actually want to get Philip on the podcast because I think I just want to know how he raises 14 kids. But
it's incredible. Yeah. It's incredible.
Yeah. Taunting. I remember one guy, and I used this line a couple of times. I would get hit or sacked or something. And like, in fact, you could taunt, you could yell, you could say whatever you wanted. And, they're kind of taunting, kind of stepping over top of me, yelling at me, saying they're gonna be all day. And, I was like, who are you? Like, turn around. Like, I don't know. Let me see your name. Like, are you on the depth chart? And you kind of flip them around. But, and I got one taunting call, at home. I got flushed out of the pocket. I was running to the left. We were actually going in to score. And I think I kind of stiff-armed a guy. And I don't think he fell down, but we kind of both went out of bounds, and I kind of just tossed him the ball. And like that's my one taunting call.
That's going to get you a penalty.
Yeah.
I always thought you would suggest it was the taunt you gave your own offensive coordinator, Mike Martz, that one time when we caught caught the audio of that. That was spectacular.
When I gave him the F-bombs?
Yes.
Yeah, what were your exact words?
I think I said, tell Mike to fuck off. I think is what I think I said.
The best. That's the best ever.
That's the kind of shit that happens all the time, doesn't it?
Oh, my gosh, yes. And Mike was so cool about it. I remember, everyone blew it up, and we're on the sideline, and he's just goes about business, like going. And then the next day, I think we were talking, he's like, I get it. You know, it sucks out there sometimes. Like, you know, I'd probably say the same thing. So he was super cool about it. You know, I've had other instances where the other side wasn't cool about it, but that's for another day.
Lovey? Did Lovey not like that sort of stuff?
Lovey was super reserved in about every regard. So, but there were different rules for the offense and the defense. Like that's just kind of, I mean, he was a defensive guy and those were his guys and, you know, he drafted them. They were running his defense. So, I mean, that was a team that was just divided just naturally. I mean, it wasn't a bad thing. We won games. You know, you just got a different sense of that team whenever I was on it. Tom, like you guys didn't have rules whenever you were playing.
Oh, well, we had leather helmets. So, I mean, like there, I don't even think we had officials. So like, listen, I was the last fucking guy that was going to taunt anyone because everyone on the field could kick my ass. Like, you know, who was I going to taunt?
Yeah.
I couldn't have taunt one of the guys on the chain gang without getting my ass kicked.
Were DBs like just yapping at you constantly?
You have no idea. Like there's so many things. My late grandfather was insulted so many times. And at one point, I said to him, I said, dude, you don't even know my grandfather. He's a great guy. All my really nice people, you know? I was an easy target early on, especially. I mean, like I would walk to the line of scrimmage and I would say I got more laughter than I got taunting comments.
Like, who's this guy?
Yeah,
I mean,
you know, like, what are you going to – like, there was one time I walked out, and it was the opening game, I think, of the 91 season, where I think Todd Scott said to me, what are you going to do? I mean, it ended up working out okay, but, I got into the end zone so infrequently, I didn't have a big celebration, you know.
But, I mean, you moved the chains. Like, you were kind of one of the first, like, third down guys, really.
Yeah. Like, they asked me to do some shit that I, you know, I wouldn't ask people I didn't like to do.
Yeah.
But
hey, run across the middle, catch the ball, and get your head knocked off.
You know, I tell people all the time, I had a couple of God-given gifts, and one of them was I really didn't care if someone whipped my ass. I mean, that's kind of, you know, I've got a different feeling about it now. I don't, at 54, don't want anyone to whip my ass. But back in the day, getting lit up didn't bother me. And I guess, you know, to be honest with you, that truly is, you know, an intangible, I guess, that
100%.
Like, I didn't care. I wasn't afraid to do it. I couldn't run past anyone, but if you asked me to sit down between the inside and an outside linebacker, I didn't have a problem with it, but
no problem.
I mean, the rules were different. You're right. Like I got hit. I got a scar on my chin. I had 25 stitches. I got like 13 on the inside and 12, you know, on the outside. And it was a gross hit. And Thomas Everett, it was in Tampa in 94. Thomas Everett come across the field.
Mm-hmm.
Steve Walsh was my quarterback at the time. He threw me a medicine ball.
Mm-hmm.
That's a pass that will send you to the doctor.
Mm-hmm.
Threw a medicine ball across the middle. And Thomas Everett just jumped in the air, lowered his head, and hit me square on the chin and knocked me out in the middle of the play. I don't believe they penalized Thomas Everett for the hit. And B, Wani was our coach. And Wani was part of the Dallas group from years past when Thomas Everett was on the team.
Yeah.
And they asked Wani about the hit. And Wani was like, I thought it was kind of clean. Like, my ass is half dead. You're clean for Wani. And Wani is making excuses for the guy that just lit me up in necessary fashion. So,
oh my. Were you knocked out?
Oh, yeah. Like, I got hit. And before I hit the ground, I was out. And when I hit the ground, I guess they said, like the trainers said, they started running onto the field before the play was even over because they thought I was dead.
Yeah.
And what hit me, the problem was my leg got collapsed underneath me. This is a funny story. Okay. If you want me to tell.
This is good.
My leg got trapped underneath me. Mm-hmm. And I ended up like doing some injury to my hip and found out I had an MCL sprain.
Oh,
so as well as my face, and there's a picture of the trainers carrying me, walking me off that they said we're going to bring out the you know how we were back in the day. Oh, yeah. I'm tough. Everyone else. Yep. Like, we're going to bring out the cart. I said, don't you fucking bring the cart out. I'm walking off this field. And they're holding my face together, and we walk off the field. We get into the locker room. It's like late in the second quarter. They throw me on the table. They throw that blue sheet over me. Yep. They start sewing up my face.
Yeah.
So I get off the thing. My knee's starting to feel a little weird.
Yeah.
They say, you know, I'll give it a try. So they took a knee pad and wrapped it around my chin strap to protect my face. They taped my knee up almost in a brace. My hip was starting to swell, but we didn't even address that. Don't worry about that one. I go out, you know, early before everyone else comes out at the half. And I'm out there trying to run hitch routes, just 6-yard hitch routes to see if I can play. And I get to 5 yards and I plant my foot. My knee keeps giving out. My knee keeps giving out. And like, I'm basically on a knee on the field in Tampa and basically in tears because I'm so hurt. B, I can feel like this is the end of my career because I was older at the time. And I'm just like, I can't, like, and the trainer is like, you're done. And Wani comes running out across the field. And by the way, I love Wani now, but at the time,
not that.
He looks at the trainer and he goes, can he go? And trainer shakes his head and I look at him and I go, coach, I you know, chin's fine, everything else, I can't plant on my knee. I'm sorry, I can't do it. And he looked at me and he goes, son of a bitch. And he turned around and he walked off. And I was like, in my own blood with a knee that was taped up, the hip swelling by the second. And that was really so kind great. Of the end of in Chicago. So
it's, you know, what can you do for me right now? I mean, it's changed a little bit, but I mean, back then that's what it was. You're going to go out there and produce or not.
I understand the frustration as well, because the only reason I was actually playing and starting in 94 was because we had 3 healthy receivers because we were down. And when I went out, they only had 2 healthy receivers. So I understood his angst, but his delivery, as my wife and I always talk about, you know, the difference between I left my shit on the floor and my wife coming over and saying, hey, you know what? I got a lot going on today. Is there any chance you can take that and put it in the laundry basket? Or, hey, dipshit, I'm not here to pick up after your dumbass, okay? Why don't you? So the delivery was a little bit, I would say, off.
Yeah. I mean, he didn't really read the room in the moment at that point.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, the room where there was blood everywhere. So, I mean, he should have been able to read.
Let's figure this one out.
Car wreck.
And I mean, locker rooms were different. Like, there was no social media, there were no cameras, there was nothing. Like, it was just a free for all of all free for alls.
But it's what I miss most of it. If anyone would ever like, look, I played from the time I was 6 years old. I retired at the age of 29. I got enough football. I miss the guys. I miss you know, I miss hanging out with the guys, playing golf on Tuesdays, bowling on you know in this during the season. On the off days and just hanging out with guys. That's what I miss most about it.
Yeah. I mean, I'll agree with that. I mean, you can find kind of competition, and I don't think you're going to find that level of competition that will match that. But that team surrounding, that camaraderie, you know, being with the guys, for me, you know, like, cause I mean, I played football, basketball, baseball. I've been on a team since I can remember, 4 or 5 years old. So, you know, whenever you're done, and then, you know, they just axed out of your life. It's like, wait a second. Like, that's been almost a second, you know, nuclear family for more than I've been alive. So, it's different.
I've always said that to Sylvia when we've talked about it. Look, it's real. When you've done something your entire life, I was fortunate. I went straight from playing because I had to, into working, but my job was in the media, and like the transition is very, very difficult. And I know what people will say. You've gotten a great start. You've made millions of dollars. I didn't make millions of dollars, but you get the point.
Sure.
But it's real. The void that's left from not being able to participate in something you've done your entire life, it leaves even the most well-adjusted. There's still a vacuum there that needs to be filled.
Yeah.
Maybe you will find that doing this is the closest thing to the adrenaline rush you get from competition.
I, you know, you know, going into it, you know, I was very hesitant, even going into, you know, starting this and before I even walk in the studio to do this, I'm like, you know, gosh, I mean, I don't really want to do this shit. Like, let's be honest, like I can just go do something else or go home. But you know, every time I do it, I'm like, okay, like this is fun. Like this is, you get that rush, you get that high. So it has been good, but it's hard to replace the other stuff. I don't think you can. I think you just have to deal with that, and you have to find your next best thing. Sylvie, you've been quiet. You want to talk about our upcoming radio situation that we got?
This is exciting, yeah, because I don't think we've mentioned it on the show. So Jay is going to be back. And Jay, I think we've settled on Fridays. Every Friday, Jay Cutler is going to be on the Waddle and Sylvie show again. And now I don't have to worry about, like, bad stares after bad questions. I mean, I could... But like now we could talk football, do what we've done for the last 40 minutes.
Absolutely.
Tell some stories, you know, talk some football, but just have fun. Like there's no expectation. I was joking with Waddle about this the other day. Like I'll never forget. Waddle was out one day and I think it was right out at the end of the 13th season. I think you had just gotten your new deal.
Yeah.
And I think that was the time that you and I were going up and down and you were fucking pissed at me.
Uh-huh.
And I looked at Yurko and I had no Waddle that show. and I was at a Starbucks and I've never asked Yurko for anything because Yurko's one of those guys that if you're not busting balls, you know, and he senses the weakness, he's going to pounce on your weakness.
Uh-huh.
So I just looked at him. I go, look, Waddle's not here.
Yeah.
Jay fucking hates me these days. would you please have my back this time? So, but we've come a long way since 2013, and
we've
done a lot of you know, fun visits since then. And we still play the highlight when you were on the beach when you first got to town, and you thought you were calling into the Waddle and Sylvie show, but you were really calling into Carmen and Yurko.
Yeah.
And you called in. And you go, I called in to talk to Steve, and we're like, who the fuck is Steve? You know, but and you still went on anyway. I think you guys have been doing some day drinking, but that's how long this back to 09 to 21. And Jay's going to be on weekly again, and we're just going to have fun.
It will, it will be fun. I'm looking forward to it. You know, like you said, there's no expectation, there's no pressure. We can have fun. And I plan to kind of go to a couple games. The boys want to go. So hopefully, we can get up there and get in studio and have some fun with it.
Yeah, in studio.
Yeah.
How are the kids? I mean,
they're good.
I'll never forget when you had Cam, and Cam's your oldest, right?
Yep, he just turned 9.
And you were standing on that stage as a proud dad, you know, and Cam may not even have been 1.
Yeah.
And we're Joe's, and now look at him. I mean, 9 years old, so that's got to be great, right?
Goes by so fast. Yeah, I mean, 9, 7, and Sailor's 5. So third grade, second grade, kindergarten, everyone's in school. It's kind of surreal. Like, when they're all gone, they're all in the house. And, I mean, Tom, you know, like, your girls are – they're gone.
Yeah, I'm the old guy here. My oldest is 28. The next one is 26. She had a birthday yesterday. Then we've got 23, and I've got a 17-year-old about to turn 18, and she just went to high school senior year first class today. So, like, my wife and I are very close to being empty nesters, and, you know, we have a great relationship, but I don't think either one of us is ready to not have a kid now. It's been that way for 28 years.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, your daughter's watched my kids at one point, a couple times.
Yeah. I could never say that on the air because it's like I always, hey, my daughter was babysitting for Jay's kids because I'd be like, well, you don't have any integrity as a radio guy. I was like, dude, I don't have any integrity as a radio guy anyway.
You sold your house to John Fox, for goodness sake.
Sold my house to John Fox, I don't know how much you know how well you know Fox. Foxy's one of the greatest guys you'll ever meet.
He was great. I mean, I loved him. I loved him as a coach. You know, it was a weird situation, you know, because he was coming in, leaving Denver with all the, you know, success they had there. That was a weird fire. He was coming into a shit show in Chicago. You know, I was on my way out. It was just, it was different, but You know, I saw really quickly why guys liked playing for him around the league. So it was it was cool.
Yeah.
But you know, it's just going back to kids. It's just amazing how kind of fast it goes. Like I feel like the days are slow, and the years just kind of the years just tick off. You know, one after another.
You're gonna let them play football if they want to?
It's a great question. You know, Cam asked me every single day. We watched the first preseason game, and he came down in one of my Bears helmets, one of my jerseys, and he just sat. I mean, the kid sat there for 2 hours in the helmet. I'm like, "This, are you not? Is your neck not hurt?" But I mean, he asks all the time, and it's one of those things that it's gonna be hard. It's gonna be really hard to tell him no. Hey, you can't do this. Especially with how much he loves it and how, you know, I did it. So it's going to be tough. I just want to get to a point where, you know, I feel comfortable with him being able to protect himself out there, him being able to handle himself. Because, you know, Kristen's not a tall or large woman. Like she's very small. And Camden right now isn't the biggest kid in the class either. So as we get older, and I'm at a point now where, you know, Tommy, you probably started really young, and I just don't know if that's really necessary. You know, I've been reading books about, you know, there's a book called Range right now. And it's basically saying that, you know, these high level people have a lot of range when they're younger doing different things, like specializing in just one thing might not be the answer to be on the elite level. And I think that's true. I mean, I played a lot of different sports, and you know, I didn't really concentrate on football till I was older. So, you know, I want to get involved in all of my kids and involved in as much stuff as they want to get involved in, and kind of just, you know, let them have fun. They're kids.
Yeah. I think the more I think about it, I don't even know that it's necessary for kids to be fully with full equipment until like maybe even to the high school. And look, I'm not a doctor, obviously, but yeah, maybe wait until you get to be a high school player. And in the meantime, you can play the sport, but play it flag football. Do it in a way that you're not compromising the safety of the kids unnecessarily at too young of an age, because listen, their brains are still developing. And the last thing you want to do is expose them to concussions at that age. So
yeah,
trust me.
The NFL doesn't hit anymore. Why would you want your 14-year-old or 9-year-old to hit when the NFL doesn't in training camp hit anymore?
That's one of the most valid points that I've heard. So like that makes a ton of sense.
Sylvie, yes. Can you believe that, Jay? Sylvie's bringing the heat.
About fucking time.
Jeez. Hey guys, fantasy football's back. There's a new app in town and it's called Sleeper. Let me tell you about it. Sleeper is a modern fantasy experience designed to connect people over sports with its integrated chat and sleek interface. Sleeper users talk more to their league mates, and their leagues simply feel that difference. It's free, unlike most apps, with zero ads. It's a genuinely premium experience. Sleeper offers fantasy NFL, NBA, and even LCS League of Legends. And it gives you total control over your fantasy draft and season. Redraft, Dynasty, Best Ball, this app is made to play fantasy sports your way. Sleeper is the fastest growing fantasy platform. Co-founded by two childhood best friends who used to send trading cards via snail mail after their families moved to opposite coasts. They eventually discovered fantasy sports and it became the glue of their friendship. Sleeper is the app they wish they had growing up, and they continue to use it to deepen friendships and keep people connected. Available at the App Store, Google Play, or on your desktop. Go to the App Store and download the Sleeper app and start playing today. Well, boys, it's been an absolute.
He looked at his watch.
I was like, oh, okay, we're done with him. It's been a pleasure, as always.
Yeah. Good luck. Can't wait to talk.
Yeah, we're looking forward to our Friday conversations as well.
It's gonna be fun. It's gonna be fun. Cool.
All right.
Thanks for coming on, guys. I appreciate it.
Yeah. Thanks, Jay.
All right. See you guys. Okay, Tom and Sylvie, obviously a pleasure, ton of fun. Really enjoyed that one. First one is in the books. I'm kind of relieved. It went better than I expected. I hope that you liked it as well. Obviously, we're going to find out on Twitter and Instagram and everything else. And hit me up. I honestly, I do want to hear whether you liked it, what you didn't like. you know, all the comments, because I feel like it went really well, but I'm sure that there's some things that people didn't like, or maybe not. Maybe it was a home run, but it was fun. I had fun. I hope you had fun too. I thought you hope you laughed, learned a few things. Next week, Nate Bargatze. I probably butchered that. I'm sure I butchered that. I am a big fan, though. He's a comedian. He's here in town. He's going to come in studio. He's got some Netflix shows. He has his own podcast. So I appreciate him taking the time to come. But I am super excited about this because I have a ton of respect for comedians. I think it's an unbelievably hard job to be funny on stage. So tune in next week. And I appreciate it. Thanks.